What if one of the biggest secrets to improving your bread dough wasn't your flour, your kneading, preferments, or stretch and folds, but simply how you add the water? A few months ago, while making my homemade pizza video, I changed one thing about adding water, and the results were great. It convinced me of something crucial. We bakers focus so much on gluten and techniques, but often overlook how vital the method of adding water truly is. Even worse, the science of how water actually works in dough is rarely explained well. Today, we're changing that, so stick around. Hey, Seraphin here. For years, I made bread dough by adding everything simultaneously. Water, flour, salt, the lot. So when I started looking into different ways of adding water to bread dough, like gradually adding it in parts or using the Bassinage technique, I was skeptical, thinking that they were just myths. However, I quickly learned these methods affect the dough structure in a fundamental way I hadn't anticipated. In short, incorporating water gradually while mixing helps to develop the gluten network differently, leading to a final dough that's noticeably easier to handle. But to fully understand how these methods work, we need to talk about the water itself. You see, the water inside our dough isn't static or inert. It's surprisingly mobile. These techniques affect that mobility, influencing how water moves within the dough to make it easier to handle. Beyond just handling, though, understanding this water mobility truly illuminates the entire bread-making process. It helps answer fundamental questions like, why does dough stop being sticky after kneading? This video could have easily been titled The Secret Life of Water in Your Bread Dough. So, why is understanding this water mobility so crucial? Well, it's because while hydration percentage tells us how much water we've added, its mobility tells us what that water is actually doing at each stage. Knowing that this mobility changes dramatically throughout the bread making process gives you insight into everything from dough handling to final crumb structure. It allows us to move beyond following recipes to truly understanding and controlling the bread making process. Okay, so here's how we'll explore the topic in this video. We'll trace water's role right from the moment it hits the flour through mixing, kneading, and those quiet periods of rest and fermentation, all the way to the intense heat of the oven. Along the way, we'll look at how traditional techniques like Bassinage or gradual water addition cleverly manipulate this water mobility at different stages. So let's start with, what does water actually do in bread dough? This may sound like an odd question, a little too simple, but if you think about it, we don't give enough credit to water. Water acts as a crucial solvent in dough, dissolving sugars, salts, and other small molecules. This is essential as it makes these components readily available for both yeast fermentation and enzymatic activity, which are fundamental processes in dough development and the creation of the final baked bread. Of course, water also plays a critical role by hydrating the essential components of flour, namely starch granules and the proteins gluten and gliadin. You probably know this well, but really, this hydration process is fundamental. It allows these proteins to interact and develop the interconnected gluten network, which gives the dough the structure and elasticity that we all love. In more technical terms, water is a plasticizer. The addition of water lowers the glass transition temperature of the flour components, causing a transformation from a rigid, glassy state to a more flexible, viscoelastic state. Furthermore, water plays a role in temperature regulation. Thanks to its high specific heat capacity, it helps buffer the dough against rapid temperature changes, moderating the heat generated during mixing. But not all water in the dough behaves the same way. Scientists often simplify its behavior by talking about two primary states, bound water and free water, although intermediate states do exist. Bound water is tightly associated with hydrophilic or water-loving components such as proteins like gluten, starch granules, and non-starch polysaccharides. Just from the name alone, you can guess that this water is less mobile. It's bound, and it doesn't freeze as easily as pure water because it exhibits a lower freezing point. This water is largely unavailable to act as a solvent or participate readily in biochemical reactions. You can think of it like water absorbed into the material of a sponge. Free water, conversely, is less tightly held within the dough matrix. It lives in the spaces and capillaries between larger molecules. It behaves much more like bulk water. It's significantly more mobile and available. This availability makes it crucial for hydrating ingredients, supporting yeast fermentation and enzyme activity, and acting as a solvent. When we handle the dough, this free water is what contributes significantly to dough properties such as stickiness. This is analogous to the water held loosely within a sponge's pores. While we won't go deep into it in this video, this free water can also be quantified by the concept of water activity, which influences microbial growth and enzyme function. And now we can talk about the bread dough. When water first meets flour, it's a rapid hydration event. Water molecules quickly adsorb onto the surface of flour particles and begin penetrating. Starch granules swell slightly, and crucially, the gluten-forming proteins, glutenin and gliadin, start to hydrate. Initially, water mobility is relatively high, contributing to that initial sticky phase. However, as the proteins and starches rapidly bind water, the amount of truly free water decreases, and thus overall mobility starts to drop. That's part of why the ultimate goal of initial mixing is uniform hydration, ensuring every flour particle gets adequate access to water before significant gluten development begins. Incomplete hydration at this stage leads to inconsistencies later on. After initial hydration, kneading is where the magic of structure formation happens, and it dramatically impacts water mobility. You'll find quite a bit of that initially free water gets rapidly incorporated and managed by the developing gluten structure. As we've discussed before in our previous videos, the mechanical energy input aligns the hydrated gluten proteins, facilitating the formation of disulfide bonds and creating the viscoelastic gluten network. This developing network forms a structural matrix, physically entrapping water. As the gluten structure becomes more organized and extensive, it gets better at doing this and binds water more effectively. More water transitions from a free state to a bound state within the gluten matrix interstices. Consequently, water mobility should decrease significantly during proper kneading. The dough becomes less sticky and more cohesive precisely because the water is becoming less mobile. It's being managed and structured by the gluten. Now, let's talk about what gradual water addition does. To recap, gradual water addition is where we add water to the dough in parts, mixing in between. This method shows up in a lot of recipes, ranging from high hydration doughs to relatively low hydration wheat doughs used during noodle making, such as for the famous Chinese lamian noodles. This study confirmed this method works well for whole wheat flour, significantly improving dough extensibility and its swelling index, among other benefits, regardless of the total water used. So if you're a baker who enjoys making whole wheat bread or using ancient wheat flours, you should definitely consider using these methods to improve the workability. But if you're not using whole wheat flour or ancient wheat, worry not. This technique also works for refined flour. In another study on refined flour compared with the control group, the rheological properties of dough made by adding water to the flour several times were significantly changed, resulting in increased elasticity and tensile strength of dough. The paper noted that adding water in two equal parts, or adding water in three parts in this ratio, made the doughs with the best tensile properties, which may be attributed to the increased gluten strength. Additionally, on a side note, I have also tried using this technique along with tangjong. You see, tangjong is a technique where a portion of the flour is mixed with boiling hot water, gelatinizing the starches. This pre-gelatinized portion binds a large amount of water, contributing unique softness and moisture to the final dough. Since both tangjong and gradual water addition involve managing dough hydration in distinct phases, I was curious to see how they would interact. Although, of course, home experiments are subjective, I did test out using both the gradual water addition technique and the tangcheong method to make pizza dough with bread flour, and the results were excellent. So what is the underlying explanation for gradual water addition? First of all, it's easy to understand why this is a favorable method for high hydration doughs. As mentioned in our videos on strain hardening, extreme high hydration dramatically increases the mobility of gluten and molecules, enabling them to align and interact more readily. This can lead to the rapid formation of a gluten network. However, while beneficial initially in speeding up the process, the heightened mobility due to hydration makes the gluten network more vulnerable to damage from excessive mixing. But when we add the water in parts, we can mix the dough at a lower hydration first, which would essentially allow for more efficient gluten formation without the risk of overmixing. There's less free water lubricating the proteins, promoting better friction and alignment, leading to easier initial gluten development and less overmixing risk. So controlling the hydration is key here at the first step. Adding water later, once the network is established, allows for the water to be incorporated more effectively into the existing structure, rather than just increasing stickiness. The developed gluten has a higher capacity to absorb and bind this new water, so we achieve a controlled final hydration that benefits the dough development. There's also an impact on gluten structure. The initial lower hydration encourages strong linkages, while the latter water addition ensures full hydration without disrupting the already formed structure as much as adding all the water up front might, especially at high hydrations like we mentioned. Essentially, you're manipulating the time of water availability relative to gluten development. Adding water to a system where mobility is already somewhat reduced due to initial kneading changes how that water integrates. A similar principle applies to adding inclusions like seeds or grains soaked in water later in the mix. You're adding water in a controlled way. Now, what happens when the dough rests? Well, in simple terms, resting accomplishes several key things. First, free water continues to move around. And so resting allows the flour to hydrate fully without intensive mechanical input. Second, resting promotes the development and strengthening of the gluten network as proteins link up, particularly the glutenin polymers responsible for dough strength and elasticity. Finally, resting allows the developed gluten structure to relax, which improves the dough's extensibility. All these factors contribute to creating a better overall gluten network. During bulk fermentation, yeast and bacteria get to work. They consume sugars and produce metabolites like carbon dioxide, ethanol, and organic acids. So how does this affect water mobility? Well, as mentioned in many of my previous videos, during dough mixing, tiny bubbles are incorporated as nucleation sites. These small spherical tiny gas bubbles serve as starting points for gas expansion. During fermentation, most of the carbon dioxide produced by yeast diffuses into these existing bubbles, causing them to grow. As gas bubbles expand, they physically displace water and end up as pockets within the dough matrix. Ethanol, or alcohol production in wheat dough, a byproduct of bread making, is caused by the fermentation of sugars by yeast. Ethanol is hydrophilic and competes with other components for water-binding sites, potentially increasing the proportion of free-er water slightly. Acidification also affects water, as lactic and acetic acids are produced by the yeast and bacteria. The pH of the dough drops. The change in pH alters the charge on the gluten proteins, affecting their conformation and their water-holding capacity. Depending on the specific pH range and protein state, this can either slightly increase or decrease water binding. Overall, during fermentation, water mobility doesn't change as drastically as during mixing or baking, but there are continuous subtle shifts. Water tends to become more evenly distributed throughout the matrix, and proteolytic activity can continue to soften the gluten, potentially releasing some previously bound water, contributing to the feeling of increased extensibility in a well-fermented dough. And what happens when the dough has more free water? Well, it gets stickier. So if you've ever wondered why your over-fermented bread dough was so sticky, now you know why. As the final step in bread making now, baking introduces intense heat, triggering the most dramatic changes in water state and mobility. Around 55 to 65 degrees Celsius, starch gelatinization is transforming the dough. Starch granules begin to absorb large amounts of free water and swell irreversibly, forming a gel. This process, gelatinization, binds a significant portion of the previously free water within the starch structure, dramatically reducing water mobility within what will become the crumb. This is key for setting the crumb structure. At slightly higher temperatures, around 70 to 80 degrees Celsius, gluten proteins denature and coagulate. They lose their extensibility and form a rigid structure, locking in the gelatinized starch granules and further trapping the remaining water, solidifying the crumb structure and further reducing water mobility. Inside the loaf, water migration occurs. However, the dominant process is water turning to steam and trying to escape. As the dough is being subjected to more oven heat, water temperature rises. Reaching 100 degrees Celsius, free water turns into steam. This steam is part of that lovely oven spring that you see when the dough rises up. The phase change represents a massive increase in mobility, and water near the surface evaporates rapidly, initiating crust formation. The crust forms as the surface dehydrates intensely, resulting in very low water content and minimal mobility. In contrast, the crumb retains significant moisture, but most of it is now bound within the gelatinized starch and coagulated protein network. Its mobility is low compared to the unbaked dough. The final moisture gradient between crust and crumb is a direct result of these differential changes in water state and mobility during baking. Then the bread is done. It's interesting to note that although baking removes a good amount of water from the dough, bread is still considered a food with a pretty high water activity, aka free water. Okay, now we've gone through the entire process of looking at water in bread from dough to baking. And as you can see, water in dough isn't static. Its ability to move, its mobility is constantly changing, influenced by ingredients, mechanical work like kneading, enzymatic activity, fermentation, and finally heat. Knowing what we do now, we can explain why gradual water addition works, how to troubleshoot dough inconsistencies related to hydration, and ultimately, how to better control the final texture, crumb structure, and shelf life of our bread. You could say that we've connected the dots between the hydration we calculate for bread dough and the dynamic reality inside of it. And that's it for this video. Thanks for watching, and bye!